Good evening, children. Welcome to the revision class in my YouTube channel of SA2. In this module, we are going to discuss about chapter 5, that is the early Mughals. And in this module, we are going to learn about the origin of Mughals. And in detail, we are going to discuss about the first two famous ruler or king of Mughals, that is Babur and his son Humayun. And later on, we are also going to discuss about Sher Shah Suri, who fought with Humayun. And there, we are also going to discuss about their administration system. And at last, at the end of this module, we are also going to discuss about the two famous kingdoms of the south, that is Vijayanagara Kingdom and the Bahamani Kingdom, at the time of these two Mughal rulers. So now let's start the sessions with the origin of Mughals and Babur's life. Origin of Mughals. So first we need to know who are these Mughals. Mughals were the descendants in the sense children or grandchildren by paternal side Timur, who was the ruler of Iraq, Iran and Turkey of today's modern time. At the time it was mainly called as Persia. And by mother side, they were the descendants of Genghis Khan, the ruler of Mongolia. First, we need to learn about Babur's life, who ruled from 1483 to 1530 Common Era. First, Babur came to India and he fought with Ibrahim Lodi in the year 1526 CE in the famous first battle of Panipat, with the help of Ibrahim Lodi's own people, that is Daulat Khan, Alauddin Khan and Alam Khan. Daulat Khan was the governor of Punjab of Ibrahim Lodi. Alauddin Khan was the governor of Lahore and Alam Khan was the uncle of Ibrahim Lodi. So due to the help of these three people, Ibrahim Lodi was able to defeat by Babur. And after defeating Ibrahim Lodi, Babur successfully founded the Mughal Empire in India, and it led to the end of Delhi Sultanate in India. That is, the last king of Delhi Sultanate was Ibrahim Lodi. Now let's discuss the reason behind the success of Babur over Ibrahim Lodi. Babur army was less as compared to the number of army of Ibrahim Lodi, but Babur's army were well trained. Little bit spelling mistake is there. Well trained, and Babur's army also used artillery, and this artillery, that means tough cannon, these all are new to the Indian rulers at that time. That means they don't know how to use this artillery and it's almost new. So with the help of this well trained army of Babur and artillery, Babur able to defeat Ibrahim Lodi. Next, Babur founded Mughal Empire in India after defeating Ibrahim Lodi in the first battle of Panipat. Later on, Babur captured different kingdoms in India which were ruled by mainly by the Rajputs. Like Babur fought in battle of Kanwa in 1527 CE and defeated Rana Sangha in that battle, and he also defeated the remaining Rajputs in the battle of Chanderi in 1528 CE. But unfortunately, after ruling for 4 years, Babur died at the age of 47 years. Like this, Babur's rule came to an end. Next, we are going to discuss about Humayun's life. Humayun was the eldest son of Babur. And he was born on 6th March 1508 as the eldest son of Babur, And Humayun also has three brothers. They are Kamran, Askari, and Hindal. After the death of Babur, before this, let us add little point about Mughal tradition of succession. Mughal tradition of succession is little bit different from other kingdoms. In other kingdoms, tradition of succession, mostly the eldest son of the king used to become the next king after the father died or after the king unable to rule the kingdom properly. But in Mughal tradition of succession, it's little bit different. In the Mughal tradition of succession, the total empire of a king was usually divided among his sons. So, in the same way of tradition of succession, Babur's empire was divided among Humayun, Kamran, Askari, and Hindal. After he became the king, after Humayun became the king of India and he ruled Agra at that time, he faced different kinds of problems. Many Rajputs were always attacking him. Many Afghans, that means the descendants of Ibrahim Lodi's, were also attacking him. Moreover, his own three brothers were also always revolted against him because they want to rule Agra. They are not happy with the share they got. That means already the empire was divided among these four brothers, Kamran, Askari, Hindal, and the Humayun. These other remaining three brothers, they want to rule Agra and they are not happy with their share. And moreover, another problem to Humayun was his army were not loyal to him, and his army consists of different communities like Afghans, Uzbeks, Mughals, Indian Muslims, Hindus, Turks, and the Persians. They were always jealous to each other. That's why they always used to fight each other. That means internal crisis was always happen in the Humayun's army. Due to this also, he always used to face problem. Due to this internal crisis, Sher Shah Suri announced himself as the ruler of Bengal and Bihar region. So Humayun was totally aimed to defeat this Sher Shah Suri. So when Humayun was going to defeat Sher Shah Suri, he listened that his brother Hindal was declared himself as the ruler of Agra. So due to this, Humayun forcefully came back to Agra to defeat his own brother Hindal. But on the way, Humayun was blocked by Sher Shah Suri's army. Due to this, he was forcefully fought with Sher Shah Suri's army in the Battle of Chausa on 26 June 1539. But Humayun's his army was defeated by Sher Shah Suri's army in the Battle of Chausa, and Humayun ran away from the battlefield. And in the next year, that is 1540, Humayun raised with 4,000 soldiers, and again he fought with Sher Shah Suri in the famous Battle of Kannauz in 1540. But unfortunately, in that battle also, Humayun was again defeated by Sher Shah Suri. And again, he was able to escape from Battle of Kannauz. And after running from Battle of Kannauz, he hid in different parts of India, like in Sindh, Kashmir area, and later on he ran to Persia. He was totally supported by the Shah of Persia, that means the King of Persia, and he raised a huge army and he was always try to attack India. Finally, Sher Shah Suri died in the year 1545. Then, and at that time, India was ruled by Sher Shah Suri's son, Muhammad Adil Shah. He was a very weak ruler and he was unable to control his administration system properly. He was supported by his prime minister, Hemu. That means Muhammad Adil Shah, the son of Sher Shah Suri, was supported by his Prime Minister Hemu. So taking the advantage of this weak king, Muhammad Adil Shah, Humayun attacked India and defeated Muhammad Adil Shah, the son of Sher Shah Suri. Like this, finally Humayun regained his territory again from the Suri dynasty. So unfortunately, Humayun died by falling from the steps of the building called Din Panha in the year 1556 CE. Remember this year, Humayun died in the year 1556 CE. Now let's discuss about Sher Shah Suri's life. Who was Sher Shah Suri and how he became king? We are going to learn in this small topic. Sher Shah Suri was born in the year 1472 CE and his birth name was Farid Khan. He was an Afghan Afghan origin family and he was born in Punjab. His father was working as an official in Bahlul Lodi's court during the Delhi Sultanate in the Punjab region. Sher Shah, from the childhood onwards, Sher Shah Suri was very intelligent and talented boy, and due to this intelligence and talentness, Jamal Khan caught the attention of Sher Shah Suri. So after Sher Shah Suri's father died, he was given the in charge of the Jagir region of his father, and then he also able to learn read and write Persian and Arabic languages easily. After the death of his father, Sher Shah Suri managed his Jagir area in 1518 CE, at that time during the reign of Ibrahim Lodi. Many scholars and many experts tell that Sher Shah Suri once saved Bahar Khan with bare hand, which means without using any kind of weapon, from the attack of tiger. So he was named as Sher Shah Suri, but his actual name was Farid Khan. So later on, due to the enmity created between Sher Shah Suri and Bahar Khan, Sher Shah Suri joined the Mughal army and he left Bahar Khan. But again, He left the Mughal army again and he came back to Bahar Khan army and he joined Bahar Khan army. But unfortunately at that time Bahar Khan was dead, and when Bahar Khan was dead, his son was very small child. So fortunately or by accidentally, Sher Shah Suri became the king of Bihar region. Due to the internal crisis was happening at between the Humayun and his three brothers also at that time, and after he became the king, he defeated Humayun in the Battle of Chausa in 1539 CE and in the Battle of Kannauj in 1540 CE. That means we can call Sher Shah Suri as one of the most successful king. Next, we are going to discuss about why Sher Shah Suri was very successful. That means the administration system of Sher Shah Suri we are going to discuss now. And Sher Shah Suri was a very brilliant ruler. In a very short span of only 7 years, that is 1538 to 1545 CE, he ruled his empire very nicely, and he even defeated the Mughal king Humayun due to his proper planning and administration system. First, he divided his empire into 47 units called sarkars, and these sarkars was again divided into smaller units called parganas, so that the ruling will become easy. Again, this each parganas was looked after by Amin, Sikdar, Treasurer, Hindu writer, and also the Persian writers. And they used to keep proper accounts of this Parganas region. Villages were mostly looked after by the Patwaris, Mukaddams, and the Chowduris. And Sher Shah Suri also used to give high salary to his soldiers, so that soldiers will be loyal to him and always they will be interest in their profession. And to protect his kingdom, he always make garrison forts in different corners of his kingdom or empire. Even he also personally look after the revenue collection system of his empire, because revenue is the main source of income for any king. He used to transfer the different revenue collector, that means tax collector, from one place to another place after every 2 to 3 years to avoid any kind of corruption in a particular area. And the mostly the tax were collected directly without involving zamindars, so that in the many histories areas we know that zamindars used to exploit it, used to cheat at the farmers, and they used to collect more taxes from the farmers. So Sher Shah Suri don't like this system. That's why he did not involve zamindars, and tax were mostly collected directly from the farmers through tax collectors. And he used to collect the taxes mainly in by 1/6 of the product or 1/2 of the product. He also introduced a silver coin called Rupaya, and he set up a police and very strong spy system to avoid corruption and any other problem in the kingdom. He was very tolerant to all the religion, that means he treated all the religion and he respect all the religion equally. So his administration system, we can call it a very effective and very famous administration system of that time. So his administration system was later adopted by the Mughal ruler Akbar, that we are going to learn in the next chapter. Now we are going to learn about the kingdoms of the south. In South India at that time, there were two kingdoms, that is Vijayanagara kingdom and the Bahamani kingdom. Vijayanagara kingdom was founded by two brothers, Harihara and Bukka, in the year 1336 CE. One of the famous ruler or king of Vijayanagara kingdom was Krishnadevaraya, and he divided the province, he divided total empire into different provinces, and he gave the responsibility of the different provinces to the royal princes, and they were known as Nayaks. This is a spelling mistake. It should be N-A-I-K-S, Nayaks. He also promoted agriculture by building tanks, dams and canals. That means he paid more attention on agriculture and improvement of irrigation system, so that farmer will produce more crops and he will get more taxes. Revenue, that is tax, that is mostly come from agriculture and the tribute paid by the governor, with those governors who are under the control of this Krishnadevaraya. Revenue was used for the development of the people and for maintenance of the army. Development of people in the sense construction of roads, canals, dams, etc. And the maintenance of the army, like giving salaries for the army, recruiting new army, etc. On the other hand, another famous kingdom of the south was, at that time, was Bahamani kingdom, and it was established in the year 1347 CE. One of the famous ruler of this kingdom was Ahmad Shah II, and he used to maintain very strong army, and he also, this Bahamani kingdoms encouraged foreign traders, and they also given the higher position to this foreign people who ever comes to this their kingdom. One of the example of it was Mahmud of Gavan. He even hold the position of a chief minister in the Bahamani kingdom, and these foreigners were mainly known as the Pardesis, and these Pardesis were again enemies of the local Muslim groups called the Deccanis, and this group executed Mahmud of Gabon in the year 1481. Executed means killed. The Deccanis, the local Muslims, killed Mahmud of Gabon, Pardesi, in the year 1481 CE. And now we are going to discuss about these two kingdoms. These two kingdoms are neighboring kingdom. Vijayanagar kingdom, empire, and the Bahamani kingdom, they were neighboring kingdom, and they always used to fight each other. There was almost 200 years of conflicts, and the reason was to capture Goa and Godavari basin and the straight routes of South India. At the time, king used to get more revenue and taxes from the trade routes, because South India is mostly connected with the sea routes. That's why kingdoms which are occupying the trade routes, they used to get more taxes, more revenues. That's why always these two kingdoms used to fight each other. Due to this fighting among the Bahamani kingdom and the Vijayanagara kingdom, the two kingdoms became very weak. And at last, these two Deccan kingdoms, South Indian kingdoms, declined. Decline means finished. And the Mughal kings came and attacked and occupied the total South India at that time. So like this, South India also again captured by the Mughal Empire. In the next chapter, we are going to learn about the later Mughals, the other remaining Mughals, that is about Akbar, religious policies of Akbar, and Akbar's court, their administration system, and so on. We are going to learn about other remaining Mughal Empire. Thank you, children. I hope you understand the total chapter 5 is properly. If there is any doubt, please share in the comment section. Thank you, children.